Hi, this is Stu Turgel, your host of The Phoenix File, a weekly news magazine and community conversation with the people and programs making a positive impact on the quality of life in our community. They call it GiGi's Playhouse, a very serious organization with a very playful name that sees a world where individuals with Down syndrome are accepted and embraced in their families, schools, and communities. GiGi's Playhouse works to increase positive awareness of Down syndrome through national campaigns, educational programs, and by empowering individuals with Down syndrome, their families, and the community. Stay tuned for tonight's edition of The Phoenix File when you'll meet Jenny and Stephanie Gage, leaders of the local chapter of this international network of Down Syndrome Achievement Centers that educate, inspire, and believe. That's coming up next right here on Radio Phoenix, where the Valley comes to talk, sing, connect. Well, good evening. I'm Stu Turgel, your host for The Phoenix File, a weekly news magazine that features the people and programs making a positive difference on the quality of life in the Valley of the Sun. You know, there are more than 450,000 individuals with Down syndrome living in the United States. And when you include affected parents and siblings, why, there are 2 million people facing this diagnosis every single day. One in 691 live births results in a Down syndrome diagnosis, with an 80 to 85% termination rate of pregnancies determined to have Down syndrome. There's a considerable amount of work needed to give babies a fighting chance for life, love, and happiness. And my guests tonight know this very well. They're inspirational women who have devoted their lives to helping those with Down syndrome and their families through their leadership of the Phoenix branch of a national organization known as GiGi's Playhouse. Jennifer Gage founded GiGi's Playhouse Phoenix in 2015 and serves as its president emeritus. She was inspired to open a playhouse here because her first daughter, Caitlin, was born with Down syndrome. Caitlin is now 21. Jennifer has lived in the Valley for 31 years, and she spent most of her adult life in philanthropy and raising her four children. And GiGi's Playhouse has been the work of her life. Stephanie Gage, Jennifer's mother-in-law and Caitlin's grandmother, is the Phoenix board president of GiGi's Playhouse. After retiring as an account executive with the Estee Lauder companies, Stephanie began to participate with Caitlin's weekly educational, therapeutic, and social programs at GiGi's. Jennifer and Stephanie share the vision belief that with help of others, they can change how the world sees individual differences and allows them to enrich our lives. So Jennifer and Stephanie Gage, thank you both for being here tonight, and welcome to The Phoenix File.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having us.
Yes, thanks a bunch.
Well, we'll talk about the extraordinary work of GiGi's Playhouse in a moment, but for the benefit of my listeners who may not be that familiar with Down syndrome, tell us a little about what it is and how it manifests itself in the people who have it. I know it's caused by a genetic disorder, but I'm not sure everyone knows really what's behind it, what causes it, and what the effects are on children and adults with Down syndrome. So can you give us sort of a Cliff Notes explanation that lay people will understand?
I think so. If you take two parents, each one has 23 chromosomes, making up 46 chromosomes in each individual. So Down syndrome occurs when there's an extra copy of the 21st chromosome, and that material can attach itself to other material in that chromosome, developing cognitive delays, health problems. It can be sometimes referred to as trisomy 21, is sort of a new thing they're calling it, most parents, rather than Down syndrome. As far as characteristics, we know that people with Down syndrome share the same characteristics in their face. They have low muscle tone, generally. They have cognitive impairment, delays in speech, and so forth. So that's sort of what it is. There was a study that came out just last week from CRNIC, Institute for Down Syndrome. And they showed definitively that Down syndrome can be categorized as an immune disorder, which is really interesting. There's a lot of science going on right now around Down syndrome. So
that's interesting. There are both physical and psychosocial implications for those with Down syndrome and for their families. So what is it? What does that mean, and how does it affect people with the disorder?
So people with Down syndrome, there's a variance of characteristics, like we talked about, sort of spanning the spectrum. So while heart problems show up in most people with Down syndrome, they don't show up in all of them. And they may be worse for some than others. So there's a lot of different aspects within the diagnosis that our kids sort of fall on a spectrum. They're unique in the way that they wear their diagnosis on their face, which I think is an interesting sort of an interesting thing to happen, because there's often a preconceived notion about these people right away. You see somebody with Down syndrome, maybe you don't understand what their capabilities are. So, that can leave a lot of interpretation. If you are not familiar with it, it can, be cause for bullying in certain circumstances and so forth.
Is it fair to say that if you've seen one person with Down syndrome, you've seen one person with Down syndrome? In other words, there's a range, an array of manifestations, of characteristics, of behaviors, of physical challenges. Not every person who has Down syndrome faces them exactly the same way.
Right. So you may have a child who is very good and very clear with their speech, and because of the low muscle tone in another child, or the enlarged tongue, they may not be able to speak. There's nonverbal children. So there really is a wide range of ability in our kids, just like there is in all populations, quite frankly.
Right. Well, with that as a background, that was a very good background. Now let's turn to GiGi's Playhouse. So tell us what it is, how and why it got started, and how it's grown and evolved since it was first established, I think, in Chicago in 2002.
Right.
Yeah,
thanks. Okay, there we go. Yes, in 2002, when GiGi Gianni was born, GiGi was born with Down syndrome. And Nancy Gianni, her mom, probably had the same kind of fears that most every mother does. You know, when you have a child at birth with a birth diagnosis, where do I go? How is this going to change my family? What's going to happen in my life? And is this baby going to have opportunities? And what am I going to do about it? And so I think as Nancy began to look at all of the different therapies and educational programs, which were very limited at that time, she was just very committed that she was going to create a community center, a center where families were going to be able to bring their families, bring their siblings, and their children with Down syndrome and their young adults, that where she would be able to provide free therapy, free educational programs, not to be their school, not to be their home or an institution of any type, but a center, a community center, where they would be able to understand each other's situation, where they would be able to bring in therapists and educators and professionals to be able to give them the type of therapy that they needed in order to reach a higher potential and to reach than what was originally thought that a baby with Down syndrome would ever achieve.
And that's really the common theme, isn't it? The ability to reach maximum potential for him or her,
right.
Whatever that may be. And it's different for each individual.
It is. We call it best of all, because it is. It is different for every individual. And so what she's been able to do now, 13 years later, is we have 35 locations. We are the only brick and mortar Down Syndrome Achievement Center. And we have 35 locations now internationally. We will open probably 10 more this next year. And we have about 200 inquiries right now who would love to open a GiGi's Playhouse in locations worldwide.
Well, there are about 30,000 families that have been served through the GiGi's Playhouse, the network of GiGi's Playhouses.
The network.
I guess is the best way of saying it. How did you all first learn about GiGi's, and when and how did you establish the program here?
So a couple of friends of mine, one of them Leslie Robertson and Val Schlesinger. So we're a group of good girlfriends. We all have children with Down syndrome. And Leslie called me one day. I was in California, and she said, "Have you heard about GiGi's Playhouse?" And I said, "Well, no, I haven't." And she said, "Well, you need to look, and we need to open one in Arizona." So I looked at it. I didn't want to do it. We did it anyway. We had to do it. I mean, once I saw what Nancy was doing in Chicago, I knew Phoenix. I was ripe for something like this. My daughter needed it. So we got a group of 10 people together, friends, neighbors, anybody we could pull in, family. And we, in 18 months, raised not enough money, but enough money.
Enough money.
To open GiGi's Playhouse Phoenix.
And that was when?
That was in February 14th of 2015. So we'll be 3 years old in a few weeks.
Wow.
Yeah.
So at that point, Caitlin was already 18.
She was 18. Yeah. She was still in high school. Uh-huh. So I knew she was about to age out. And,
right.
And that's a concern. That's a real concern for parents of adult people with Down syndromes.
Well, GiGi's Playhouse Down Syndrome Achievement Center's mission is to change the way the world views Down syndrome through a variety of national campaigns, educational programs, and by empowering individuals with Down syndrome and their families and the community. These centers offer free, and Stephanie, you mentioned free several times, and I know,
because
I've also heard Nancy talk about it on the videos on their website. These centers offer free therapeutic and educational programming to individuals with Down syndrome and their families. So tell us about the approaches you use in addressing this mission and the goals that you share with all of the GiGi Playhouse programs around the country, because those goals are common to you all.
They are, and I think making sure that that we are consistent. I think that is when you look at 35 playhouses, we have a model that where we are 100% volunteer, and it's very important that our programs maintain a very consistent level of excellence, and that we are providing to the families what they need to help their child reach their best of all. Also, I think, you know, connection to those families, really looking at some of the problems that they're facing right now, making sure that we are very understanding and we see, you know, maybe where we need to broaden the programs or the information that we provide to them. With the growth that we've had at GiGi's, which is, you know, just 40% just in the last year. I mean, the first year we went from 85 families at the end of the first year to now 500 families that we will service in
GiGi's Playhouse here in the Phoenix, Scottsdale area.
Yes. Yeah. One of the fastest growing in the country.
500 families.
500 families. And you know, our valley is spread out from east to west, so it's not always convenient to, we're not just a Scottsdale location or a certain area. We cover the entire valley, and these families bring their...
So everyone comes to you.
Comes to us.
You have a single site.
We have a single
site. Location.
That's
but they
exactly
come from
right.
all over the valley.
And we have programs every single day. So we are open 7 days a week, not only with our programs, but with our tutoring. And I think that's really what's made such a big difference. We work with school curriculums, and you know, with our reading and our math tutoring programs, we have just seen phenomenal results.
Well, we're going to get into the programs in more specific terms in a minute. We want to take a quick break for some messages, and then we'll talk about the programs of GiGi's Playhouse when we continue my conversation with Jennifer and Stephanie Gage. You're listening to The Phoenix File. I'm Stu Turgel, and this is Radio Phoenix. Welcome back to the Phoenix File. I'm your host, Stu Turgel. And here in the studio tonight, my guests, Jennifer and Stephanie Gage, and now more of our conversation about GiGi's Playhouse. Well, there is a particular structure that is common among all of the GiGi's Playhouse programs around the country, and your programs fall into several basic categories. So can you explain them to us?
I can. I'll take that one. First of all, our signature programs. I kind of referred to that a moment ago. These are our consistent programs and available in all 35 playhouses. And these are, purposeful progression programs where we start at birth. And with our commitment to have a lifetime of programs, you will have programs that work with young babies and developing their physical fitness needs. We also have then as we move into say to 3 to 5 year olds, we also have our leaps and bounds program, which is kind of that it's getting them ready for tutoring, it's getting them ready for their school as they be. It's kind of their preschool program, and then again, it just continues to travel. I mean, we talked about a moment ago, everyone is going to progress at a different rate. And one of the things that we do at GiGi's is we track that very carefully with families so that we are graduating our participants through the different programs, but we are also looking at their individual needs and how we can best meet those needs. Mm-hmm. So we have our teen programs where we are far more social, really teaching them how to interact, make eye contact, make friends, and a lot of things. We're kind of bursting at the seams right now as well. So it's really looking at how we can do more adult programming. And you will see in our future how we bring GiGi Prep School and GiGi University into our adult signature programs.
I've heard it mentioned before that there's something called Generation G. What is Generation G?
Well, Generation G is a decision, a conscious effort to be better every day. And our motto is to be accepting, be generous, and be kind.
Can't ask for better mottos than that. Your programs are separated by age cohorts, is that right?
They are. We start at babies, and with our young babies, that's really our fastest growing area. And we have, like I said earlier, therapists and educators who lead these programs with our volunteers. This is where we are really working with the entire family. They are bringing the babies in. We are able to celebrate. We are able to reduce their fears and give them a place where they can meet other parents and look at all of the different opportunities for their child's potential. We use sign language. We use music. We use LMNOP stands for language, music, and our little peeps. And it's really a great weekly program. And so parents really do get to know one another. They tell me that GiGi's is their new Google for Down syndrome.
That's great.
So they really do get a lot. They exchange a lot of great information, the families.
So who are the wonderful people that are working with these wonderful Down syndrome folks that you're dealing with?
We are volunteer supported. Uh-huh. And I'm going to tell you, we just did an orientation on Sunday, and it is a variety. I think that you came in contact with one of our young volunteers.
I did.
Ava. And I think the main thing with is that we are seeing a lot of young people who are interested in learning more about people. They're inquisitive, and they're particular about what it is that they want to do in their philanthropy. And we have them walking through the door and wanting to make friends. You know, sometimes they even have their own difficulty in making friendships, and so they can relate to our kids. And So we have young adults, we have organizations like National Charity League, Boys Team Charities that work with us, we have And then we also have a very strong group of therapists.
Well, that was what I was going to mm-hmm. ask. They're not
educators.
All, these are not all lay people. You have no. both lay volunteers
yes.
and professionals,
and professionals.
Clinicians as well.
Mm-hmm. That donate their time to our kids and to all of our participants.
And some of them are still working. You know, some of them are
oh,
retired,
absolutely.
But some of them work and then they come and they volunteer at GiGi. So it
absolutely.
Really is about their passion for our children and what we're doing.
So what is it like at GiGi's Playhouse? When
well, you have to stand in the parking lot and listen because you can hear it. You can hear it out in the parking lot. It is. There's music playing and there's families discussing and there's kids running around and they're interacting and we involve them in all of this therapy and education is hidden in fun. So if you come into GiGi's Playhouse, I mean, you're smiling all the entire time that you're there because everybody is having a great time and they're really getting to, and yet we are also able to provide the game, the program, the structure that is teaching them how to help their child to be better, to be their best of all.
Well, I'm guessing you didn't figure all this out on your own. You must get some measure of support or direction from the GiGi's Playhouse folks in Chicago.
Of course, yes. Yeah. I mean, they have developed all of our programming. They've developed our metrics. They've given us a lot of checklists that we've used to get through startup, to get through fundraising events, to sort of, you know, there's this primer, you know, about how you're supposed to do everything.
Right.
And then you sort of take that and you Phoenix size it, if that's a word, and you make it your own. but we, you know, we're free to families, but it's not free for us. So we really have to go out in the community.
Well, I was just about to ask you, how is it that you finance this what seems to me to be a not insignificant enterprise?
You know, we're actually pretty lean. As far as nonprofits go, it's not too bad. We're good, but we are expanding. So mm-hmm. with the expansion of programs, of course, comes extra expense in the space.
But you need equipment and you
we
have
do.
Physical
we
space
do, yes.
and I don't know what else, transportation and whatnot.
Well, yeah, I mean, all of that. And so our funding comes from several sources. Friends and family and general donations make up a large percentage. Corporations such as Valley Toyota Dealers, who have been with us since the very beginning, are on board. We have written several successful grants, our largest one to date being with Arizona Sports and Tourism Authority, which, you know.
Go figure,
but they're funding GiGi Fit.
Good for them.
Yep, which is great. And APS is funding our math tutoring program. Right now, we have third-party fundraisers. There's an awesome fundraiser going on with Four Peaks Brewery and General Concepts. And if you know them, they own the Vig, Linger Longer Lounge, the Womack. Right. I could go on and on.
Womack is a great sponsor here. We know the Womack.
We love the Womack.
Right.
Right. And so they are donating $2 the entire month of January for every beer you drink, every Four Peaks, Golden Amber, that you drink. So that's pretty exciting. And we hold annual events like our GiGi Gala, which is coming up on April 13th.
Where is that?
It is going to be at Luso Fine Motors in Scottsdale, hosted by Mario Lopez from Extra. I know.
Oh, wow.
And Nancy Gianni.
Oh, you're going to have Nancy,
Nancy
here.
Gianni.
Our national mm-hmm. founder. Yeah.
That's really going to be very, very special. How did Mario... How'd you get mine?
We have connections.
You have ways.
We have a guy.
So how do families find you?
Well, we're pretty, we think we're pretty easy to find. We're right off the 101 at Shea if you're looking for a location at 92nd Street in
Shea. How do they become aware of you?
Really going to the website.
Uh-huh. So tell us what the website
is. It's just ggsplayhouse.org /Phoenix.
Okay.
And that way they can find our location, they can find how to reach us, and they can also look at all of our programs and our calendar.
So... Jennifer, you talked mm-hmm. a little bit about the financing and the need for donations, as every nonprofit does, but you also have needs for volunteers as well.
We do.
Right.
We do,
so
absolutely.
If somebody hears this and decides that this is something that's stirring them and
then we have a place.
Then you have a place for them. And
we
how do
place.
They reach you?
And really, through our website, there's an actual area there for volunteers, and it will tell them how to contact us. It will tell them when our volunteer orientations are, and we actually have a sign up program right there on the website where they would be able to sign up for any GiGi volunteer opportunity that they would like.
That's great. Well, Nancy Gianni, as we've talked about tonight, is the founder, and she calls herself the chief belief officer. And she's also Gigi's mom. And I want to close by sharing some of Nancy's words. She says, differences do not discriminate. They don't care who you are. They don't care if you are rich or that you're a low risk or that not those kinds of people. Differences are the ultimate leveler, and they're seconds away. When you experience that difference in yourself or in the life of someone you love, things change drastically, and you'll find yourself yearning for a more accepting world for that person that you love. And I think that the both of you really are examples of those words. So Jennifer and Stephanie Gage, I want to thank you both for being here tonight, and thanks for all you do for the young people and the older people, for the Gigis and the Caitlins, each of whom is beautiful, courageous, capable, and always worthy of acceptance, generosity, and kindness. Thanks for being here tonight.
Thank you so much for having us.
Stuart.
And that's our show for this week. Thanks again to my guests tonight, Jennifer and Stephanie Gage of GiGi's Playhouse. Join me next Tuesday night at 6:30 for another conversation about the very best in our community who are improving the quality of life and the value of the sun. Until next week, thanks for listening to The Phoenix File. For Radio Phoenix, this is Stu Turgel.